Blessings, everyone. Thank you for tuning in to Biblical News Source. Your support is immeasurably important to helping this ministry continue. Before we get started, let me tell you about our sponsor. Are you tired of healthcare that doesn't fit your budget? Well, there is good news. You don't have to go broke. We are sponsored today by Crossway Connect, a healthcare sharing ministry based on the biblical principle of carrying each other's burdens through sharing. Members make monthly contributions to a pot that is used to cover medical bills and expenses. You are probably thinking there are tons of healthcare sharing ministries out there, and that's true, but Crossway Connect is different. Their healthcare programs utilize banking technology, ensuring unmatched security and transparency of your monthly payments. When you enroll, you'll be issued an FDIC-insured bank account, which will hold your monthly payments until they are used to share medical expenses. This bank account is issued in your name, so you'll receive a statement each month that shows how much money is in the account and how much has been shared. And since it's an FDIC-insured account, you can rest easy knowing your money is safe and secure. They also have a great deal of additional benefits, including features such as phased-in sharing of expenses related to pre-existing conditions, sharing of mental health and therapy expenses, sharing of maternity and neonatal expenses, discounts on prescriptions, dental, hearing, and vision, the choice to visit any licensed medical provider worldwide, and access to free telemedicine services. Plus, you get the added bonus of knowing that you are supporting a Christian ministry based on biblical values. They have membership plans starting at $199 a month, so don't miss out on this opportunity. Go check them out at crosswayconnect.org or call at 866-427-6779. And either way, use code 10MinuteChurch, no spaces, no caps, or use the link in the bio for this episode to begin an application. Welcome to Biblical News Source, everybody. I'm your host, Chris Wright, and we've got some great stories for you today. Some stories that to examine on all sorts of topics. But before we get started, I was going to do for this segment anyways, I was going to do some examination of some Twitter escapades that I've had in the over the past week, or a few weeks, actually. I decided to start advertising on Twitter to start to get some more followers, just to build up everything for the ministry and everything. So I set aside some money to put some ads out there, and for the most part, the ads received a lot of positivity, and I did gain some followers, which is always cool. I love having a ton of followers because my goal is to bring the message of Jesus and to as many people as I possibly can, to show them that thinking about God and thinking about the Bible, thinking about Christ, is not just a belief process. It's actually an intellectual process, a process that we all can engage in. We can compare Christ with different viewpoints in the world and with investigate every topic and see how it relates to him. We don't have to just rely strictly on the Bible. For believers, for Christians, the Bible is our guide. Yes, it's the ultimate guide. It's where we should go, because to us it's his word, and we should allow that to guide us. But at the same time, that shouldn't just be the only source that we go to. There's plenty of other things we should be reading and examining so that we can weigh the evidence to get to the full scope and view of the truth of reality. And so I put two different advertisements out. The first advertisement I put out stated, "I'm an intellectual man of God. My website, 10MinuteChurch, is full of articles, videos, podcasts designed to bring everyone easy access to real, honest theology in a matter of minutes." And then I invited them to check out the website and then also give me a follow for more content. Speaking of, if you haven't followed me on Twitter, I'll put my Twitter ID in the bio for this episode, and I do recommend that you come and follow me, because I am doing some extra content on Twitter that is not being shared other places, such as the series on exposing the modern secular gods, which is actually ancient gods that are still active in our society today, and that's a really fun one. So I definitely highly recommend that. But anyways, getting back to where, to the ads, that was what the ads said, that I'm an intellectual man of God, and then tells them about my website and everything. And then the second one I put out there was, give me a second, I'm scrolling up to it. Man, it's all the way up here. Here we go. We are at war with the religion of self in our culture. A return to the eternal God, our creator, is the only chance we have. And then again, I invited them to come and check out my website and then give me a follow for more content. And like I said, for the most part, both those ads received a lot of positivity. I was able to get some followers, but there were a few people that responded, and I just wanted to go over their comments and also offer my own responses to a couple of them. The first one, actually, I like this one guy. He at first I was kind of offended by his comment, but then at the same time I looked over the picture that was on my Twitter profile, and I unfortunately couldn't argue with what he said. He said this guy looks like he isn't allowed within 500 feet of schools, and at first I wasn't too keen on that, because a lot of times people will look at white males and they'll just immediately assume that those white males are perverts and that they're after children. And if anyone who has met me and followed anything that I've done knows that I'm a huge advocate for fighting for the protection of children against pedophiles. I absolutely abhor pedophiles. I think they're disgusting, and they shouldn't be allowed to walk the streets among us. Personally, they should all be locked up for a long period of time. Frankly, in my own personal view, I think the biblical view of justice for pedophiles, which was the death penalty, should still be enforced. But then the more I looked at my picture, and unfortunately, it was an older picture of me, and it wasn't exactly the best take. So I unfortunately could see why someone would get that view of me, and for that, I apologize for putting up that picture and causing such confusion, because that's not who I am. I'm actually quite different, which is why I actually updated my profile picture to a nice photo of my wife and I on our recent cruise where I officiated a wedding. We had a great time and everything, and it was a much better picture, much more appealing. And sometimes we need that kind of criticism. You know, we're not perfect. We're humans. We're broken. And we need others to actually speak up, give us healthy criticism. But unfortunately, there's others who give us not so healthy criticism, or which is not really criticism at all. This one lady responded to the ad saying, "There is no such thing as an intellectual man of God," and then laughed. And to that, I was not as much offended as puzzled. Because it was one of those moments where it's like, tell me you don't know your history without telling me you don't know your history. There have been countless examples of intellectual men of God. I could name several off the top of my head: Tertullian, Origen, Saint Augustine. I just started stumbling there. Jeez. More modern ones would be like Kierkegaard, Luther, Calvin. I don't really follow the views of Calvin. I think his, at least on predestination, I mean, he was a very intellectual man of God. He was super, a lot of the stuff he wrote was very thoughtful, and he was a great philosopher. Some of the stuff he does, then again, we're not meant to agree with everybody. There's certain aspects of all different viewpoints that we're supposed to weigh and we're supposed to think through. And we're not always going to have the same opinions. That's why we have to critically think about things and examine them thoughtfully to sort of get down to the roots of truth that they contain, and to get to a collective view of the truth of reality. But there's others too, like William Lane Craig, probably the most intellectual man that we've had in modern times would be C.S. Lewis. He was a great philosophical and intellectual thinker in the Christian faith, and he was a devout man of God. He wasn't originally. He was a reluctant convert who was buried in atheism for the longest time, but he became probably the most impactful and intellectual man of God in our modern times. And there's other philosophers that could be named, even in the Middle Ages, Boethius, Thomas Aquinas, the list could go on. So just to come out and blatantly say there is no such thing as an intellectual man of God, that's an ungrounded assumption. And frankly, I wanted to ask this lady to provide her evidence that there's no such thing as an intellectual man of God, because there have been plenty. And it's disturbing to come on and just blatantly say, ungroundedly, that there is none. Like, you're welcome to hold that belief, but in order to validate it, you need to provide your own evidence for your side, which she did not. And it was, it kind of hurt me because of the fact that the way she did it was kind of anti-intellectual. She was accusing me of being of not being an intellectual man, and saying that there was no such thing as an intellectual man of God. But I think about God and the world in all different subjects all the time. I'm very intellectual, and it is kind of insulting the way they do that, and they come on and they just it's I wouldn't say it's slander, but it's the typical way when you're on the social media nowadays for people not to actually have intellectual conversations about different matters and points of view. They literally just come on and they will do ad hominems and attack the person instead of actually discussing the ideologies. And that causes a lot of problems in our society nowadays. Which is why recently I just responded to a post, because it was I don't know if you follow Libs of TikTok, but they shared another video of a preschool teacher who was just literally teaching her children on TikTok through video gender ideology, and of the fact that the assumption, the ungrounded assumption, that there are thousands upon thousands of genders that anybody can choose from. And one person responded to that saying that non-binary does not exist. Forcing people to address a single person as they/them is an attack on the English language. Kids do not go to school to be seen or loved. They go to school to be educated, which he's absolutely right. To which I added a continuity to his thought, and I said, the broad procedure now is to teach kids what to think instead of how to think, which is why we have seen a measurable drop in IQs. Critical contemplation requires the active comparison and contrasting of multiple available viewpoints, information, and data sets, a weighing of the evidence, in other words. But they don't want kids doing that, because if they do, then they will develop minds of their own and be capable of successfully contributing to society in beneficial ways. We need to get back to the roots of education and abandon this Marxist anti-intellectualism, which is the absolute truth. The social Marxism that's at work in our country right now is anti-intellectual. It's working in order to tell people what to think, which is indoctrination, instead of telling them how to think. The entire procedure of education since Greek times, and even before that, was to influence people to think for themselves. To present them with different viewpoints and evidence and encourage them to process it and then come to their own conclusions, which is the entire purpose of rational thought, the entire process of it. We're not meant to just take in information. We're meant to take in information and mull over it, think through it, and process it so that we can better understand what it means and how it corresponds to reality. Which is, it's funny that I wrote that, because then I went to this psalm here, and it was Psalm 49. And this is what it says. I just want to read it. I want to read the whole thing to you. It says, "Hear this, all you peoples. Listen, all who live in this world. Both low and high, rich and poor alike, my mouth will speak words of wisdom. The meditation of my heart will give you understanding. I will turn my ear to a proverb. With the harp, I will expound my riddle. Why should I fear when evil days come, when wicked deceivers surround me? Those who trust in their wealth and boast of their great riches. No one can redeem the life of another or give to God a ransom for them. The ransom for a life is costly. No payment is ever enough, so that they should live on forever and not see decay. For all can see that the wise die, that the foolish and the senseless also perish, leaving their wealth to others. Their tombs will remain their houses forever, their dwellings for endless generations, though they had named lands after themselves. People, despite their wealth, do not endure. They are like the beasts that perish. This is the fate of those who trust in themselves, of their followers who approve their sayings. They are like sheep and are destined to die. Death will be their shepherd, but the upright will prevail over them in the morning. Their forms will decay in the grave, far from their princely mansions. But God will redeem me from the realm of the dead. He will surely take me to himself. Do not be overawed when others grow rich, when the splendor of their houses increases, for they will take nothing with them when they die. Their splendor will not descend with them. Though while they live, they count themselves blessed, and people praise you when you prosper. They will join those who have gone before them, who will never again see the light of life. People who have wealth but lack understanding are like the beasts that perish." In other words, critical thought, the ability to rationalize, the ability to actually contemplate and come to an understanding of the world, is far more valuable than what the world has, than the material riches that the world offers. That this is a no new teaching. Anybody who's read the Bible or read any other ancient manuscripts from other societies, there's many that have come to this conclusion, to show that thinking through life and trying to understand it, to get a grasp on reality and know how to navigate it, is far more valuable than pleasing the self with menial, mediocre, mundane material riches and wealth. Matter of fact, I think it was Marcus Aurelius, it was a quote from him, he said the most difficult task, and I'm just paraphrasing, but he said the most difficult task is the taming of the self, and basically went on to say that he who tames the self is much rewarded. It was no secret to the ancients and until like 15 minutes ago that pleasing the self was, that pleasing the self was not the way to go, that it led to heartache and sorrow and a lack of fulfillment, and in some cases even to death. How many suicides have we seen from people who have not found satisfaction by pursuing their own personal desires? The desires of the heart are faulty. And if we pursue our will, 99.99% of the time, we are going to find ourselves destroyed rather than lifted up. And unfortunately, like I said with my one advertisement, we're at war with the religion of self. Right now, our society is telling us that we need to please the self. We need to satisfy our own personal desires. But the problem is we live in community. We're not alone. We all have different desires. And those desires will conflict. And when we force other people to bow to our own desires, that's slavery. We are making them slaves to our will, which is evil and tyrannical and destructive. It is not conducive to the building of a healthy, flourishing society. And we need to counteract it. For those out there who are trying to teach people what to think instead of how to think, I encourage you to seriously rethink your stance, because you are the catalysts to the ruination of all society. We have some more stories coming up, and we will be back real soon after a quick commercial break, so please stay tuned. Welcome back to Biblical News Source, everybody. I'm your host, Chris Wright. And before we get back to our next story, this is a reminder that our sponsor is Crossway Connect. They are a healthcare sharing ministry designed with you in mind. They are budget-friendly, offer tons of extra benefits. But most importantly, and what sticks out for me, is they are dedicated to biblical principles. These principles are crucial to them from both a religious and legal standpoint. It is due to the religious foundation of their healthcare sharing ministry that they are able to operate outside of the Affordable Care Act regulations, so it's important that all members share the same religious beliefs. These are their stated shared beliefs. We believe in the Bible's teaching to love your neighbors as yourself, regardless of race, religion, or creed. We believe we have an ethical duty to God and one another to maintain a healthy lifestyle and avoid abusing food, alcohol, tobacco, over-the-counter drugs, prescription drugs, and abstaining from illegal drugs. We believe in the biblical instruction to lessen the burdens of others by sharing medical bills together. And we believe in the biblical standard of good stewardship to be sensible and responsible in medical spending, not placing the burden on other members. What you hear is what you get. No gimmicks. They are sensible, honest, ready to serve, and grounded in the principles of our Lord. Use code 10MinuteChurch, no spaces, no caps, when you check them out at crosswayconnect.org or call at 866-427-6779 or use the link in the bio for this episode to start an application today. I was going to keep going with a new story, but that tweet I talked about in the first segment has kind of taken off. It's become probably the most popular tweet I've ever put on. I didn't mean for it to. I was simply just stating a fact of our reality right now. For those of you who missed the tweet, I was replying to a post that libs of TikTok made, talking about a recording of a preschool teacher on TikTok who was using ventriloquism to teach children third-person pronouns and how we need to respect pronouns, and somebody accurately responded saying non-binary does not exist, forcing people to address a single person as they/them is an attack on the English language. Kids do not go to school to be seen or loved. They go to school to be educated. And then I responded, the broad procedure now is to teach kids what to think instead of how to think, which is why we have seen a measurable drop in IQs. Critical contemplation requires the active comparison and contrasting of multiple available viewpoints, information, and data sets, a weighing of the evidence, in other words. But they don't want kids doing that, because if they do, then they will develop minds of their own and be capable of successfully contributing to society in beneficial ways. We need to get back to the roots of education and abandon this Marxist anti-intellectualism. And that tweet took off. It's been getting positive feedback for the most part. I but it's at 9,000. It's almost at 10,000 views right now, and I don't think I've ever gotten 10,000 views before. So I'm kind of shocked, to be honest. But there have been super replies that I think I need to go over, just like I did for the other tweets in the first segment, because there's some important responses. I wasn't sure if I was going to respond to this guy, because a lot of times people come up and talk about this stuff. Usually we'll have, I won't say that this person would not respond or would respond in a poor way, but I've had countless examples where I've tried to talk to somebody who's on the opposite side of the, on the opposite side of the, well, I can't even think right now. Jeez, I'm talking on the opposite side of the subject and on the opposite side of the political aisle, as it were, or the cultural aisle, as it were, that they would not respond well. They would either, like I said, ad hominem attacks, or they would not really have a good, adequate response. So I'm debating whether to actually respond to this guy on Twitter, but I am going to respond to him here. What he said was, in response to what I tweeted, "Sounds like the vapid remarks of someone who either doesn't have kids or is so removed from their education that he believes whatever conservative propaganda is fed them. Kids still do math and science. We can nurture their minds and their hearts at the same time." Tons of things that could be said in response to this. First thing, my wife and I are actually trying for our first child. So I am excited to probably start that next stage soon. But at the same time, as another person responded to him, sorry, give me a second. I'm trying to scroll through at the same time as I'm doing this. He said to, in response to this guy, said, "Our kids have been declining on the world stage in math, science, and reading for decades. Our kids can barely read. Having kids isn't needed to understand GRASS stats and state scorecards. Do your homework." He's absolutely right. Like, you don't have to have children and be in the experience of being a parent in order to understand the stats and the numbers and the evidence that's being presented forward with these in the situation in our culture right now. The truth is that there's a growing illiteracy and a decline in actual critical thought in our society, and unfortunately that's becoming rampant, which is disturbing, because as I talked about in the beginning, a society cannot function without communal living with people who actually can think critically and understand the world. We can't live in reality if we don't study reality and understand reality. Unfortunately for the liberal left, many times their belief system asserts, doesn't really argue, but asserts that there is no such thing as absolute truth. Of course, We brought this up before in this show. Absolute, stating that statement, there is no absolute truth, is an absolute truth in itself, so it's automatically self-defeating. There has to be an absolute truth, because that statement automatically cancels itself out as an absolute truth. So even if you were to utter that statement, you're still speaking something that's absolute, which means we can't get away from absolute truth, and we need to determine what the absolute truth is and follow it. By any means necessary, which is by weighing the evidence and trying to understand the reality that we live in and our purpose here. And it's this guy's response also, and this is where it gets disturbing for me, saying that it's so removed from education. I don't like declaring my degrees on here. I'm not, because I don't I'm a thinker. That's what I am. That's who I am. I'm a researcher. It's what I do. I am an expert in theology, but I research and read in everything else. And I'm not departed from, so removed from their education or the education of children, because I read this all the time, and I also am a huge history buff. So for a history lesson here, let's go ahead and talk about how education came to be. The university and the education system was originally designed based on Christian and biblical principles and emerged from the church, and it emerged to study the Bible and the world together to get a better grasp on both the Bible and reality, to understand how they interacted, where they merged, how to best understand what was going on in the text, and all the other subjects emerged from that collective study, and they were all seen as a way to inform each other in order to get a full grasp on reality. It was not until secularism or scientism, which is the religion saying that there is only material and only science is valuable, as in empirical science, started taking hold, that the subjects were separated from each other and not allowed to communicate and talk to each other and have the communal vibrance that they had before in order to seek out the truth and wisdom of life and to better understand reality as a whole. And when that happened, not only was theological study affected, but philosophy, history, literature, all of that started being put at the wayside so that empirical science could be put at the top. And because of that, much of the precious history and not just the Bible, but a lot of history was pushed to the wayside, and the ancients were ignored because they were seen as less intelligent and less worthy of study than modern scientists who were just now diving into the empirical side of the world to get a better view of reality. And because of that, a lot of people, students, children, you name it, even adults, are losing their appreciation for tradition and for history and for the fullness of scope of human life and human study, and a lack of value for logical thought and rational thought, which actually emerges from philosophy, not from science. In fact, science would be, we would be incapable of doing empirical science if it was not for philosophy, because empirical science is just data. It's observing what's happening in the world. The scientists still are required to make interpretations, and in order to evaluate whether they're interpretations are valid, meaningful, and worthy of our attention, and to determine if they are actually connected to reality or if they are conflated interpretations based on preconceived beliefs of the scientist rather than on the actual data that's put forward. Logical principles, the principles of logic which emerge from philosophy, are necessary in order to critique the work. Same as if you were studying history or the Bible or theology or anything for that matter. It all comes back to the principles of logic, which are used to critique interpretations of those other subjects and then determine if the interpretations are accurate, valid, and worthy of pursuit. That's why all of our major academic doctorates are called doctorates of philosophy, because they are doctorates of thought. Human thought and critique, how to think, are more important than what to think. And because our world is losing those tools and is not utilizing them in the way they used to, there's a lack of appreciation for them. And because of that, there's a lot of truly thoughtless people in our society that are just going with the flow and not actually asking questions. I personally appreciate my time that I had at a liberal arts university when I was an undergrad, because it allowed me to see both sides, the conservative and the liberal, of just about every subject. And it allowed me to study both sides and then make the decision of which side I was going to keep with. I decided to keep with my conservative Christian roots because I believe that Christianity explains the world much better and explains the history of humanity far better, and the universe too, than any other worldview that is being offered out there right now. Another guy tweeted, and this kind of goes along the same lines. Sorry, I pulled it up. He said, this person, in response to me, has a valid point. My 40 plus years as an educator make me shudder at the current state of affairs in education. The far right and religious zealots are destroying our schools. Yet again, my response there, the previous response I just gave to the other one, still applies. First off, he's saying the far right and religious zealots are destroying our schools. That emerges from a disassociation from history and from a desire to progress, which is largely on the left side. And it's funny how they always say we need to keep moving forward and progressing and modernizing, but they don't ever say what we're actually moving toward. Do you ever find that interesting? Like, it's always progressing, but doesn't say where we're progressing to. They're quite clear of where we are progressing away from, and that's from the traditions of the world. But if we're abandoning the traditions of the world, and not just Christian traditions, but traditions all over, what are we progressing to? And the truth is, there's no real answer to that on their side. They don't really have an answer. If we're progressing away from the standards of rational thought and the standards and the traditions of ancient societies, especially Christian traditions, which were the foundation of the West, then what are we going toward? There's no other standard. We could argue the existence of God, I could give the moral argument here. It would take a long time, so I won't, but suffice it to say that without God, without something above us, then the only standard is us, which is what we're witnessing in our society right now. I call it the religion of self. It's narcissistic. It's focused on pleasing the person rather than working for the benefit of the community. And it's structured to dismantle the very fundamental building block of society, which is the traditional human family. One husband, one wife, who have children and raise children together in a lifelong union. It literally is targeted toward destroying that. This person wants to dismantle what he calls far right and religious zealots, which 99.9% of the time refers to Christians. So this is Christian hate. Funny how they'll say, oh, well, you shouldn't hate on trans people, you shouldn't hate on gays, you shouldn't hate on anybody else, but all of a sudden when it comes to Christians, they're allowed to hate on Christians all they want and then act like it's nothing. And it, basically, this person wants religion removed from the school. He wants any religion. But the problem is, we can't get away from religion. And that's what I'm trying to make. If you want to remove religious zealots and religion from the schools, like taking the Bible out, you've got to replace it with something. And the only way to replace it, the only thing to replace it with is secular religion. And as we're seeing right now, secular religion, the religion of the self, is destroying society. It's slowly eroding the foundations of everything that was built, not just in the West, but even in the East. It's grabbing a hold of Eastern religions. A lot of these religions that are pantheistic and believe that we should follow who we are and live out our best self and learn how to mold ourselves into who we think we should be. A lot of that stems from ancient Eastern thought, ancient Eastern religion. It's about, although even a lot of them were about disciplining the self and about honor and about obligation rather than about pleasing the self. We're talking about a metaphysical, mystical kind of doctrine and agenda that is oriented toward removing thought, removing and replacing it with feeling. And unfortunately, a lot of parents are not stepping up, which they should be. A parent's job is not to endorse the desires of their children. A parent's job is to protect their children, protect them from being preyed upon by the evils of the world, being preyed upon by those who want to extort them and enslave them, by who want to force their opinions and doctrines and beliefs on them. I'm not saying that the church hasn't had a history of that, because there have been unfortunate times where the church has done that. And it was correctly chastised in those times. But replacing a faith system that was at some points forced upon people with another belief system that is actively being forced upon people is not correct. Again, as we said in the beginning, if you force your belief system on somebody else, then you are enslaving them. You're not building them up. The point of education was to build people up, to turn them into productive members of society who could contribute to the benefit of all. When you take that premise away from education, then it just becomes an indoctrination center. I would recommend you all check out James Lindsay. If you haven't checked him out, definitely do. He's an expert in this, and he's awesome in his writings on the way neo-Marxism is taking over not just the world, but our education system in the United States. His book, I can't remember the title of it right now, The Marxification of Education, something like that. I'm still actively reading it, and I don't have it pulled up here, but he talks about how Paulo Freire, who was an avid Marxist, is the one who wrote several writings intended on laying out a template of education, where education was meant about building up the personal identity of the children, of instilling in them the ideas of Marxism, that they should revolt and overturn society, but better than that, but or further than that, they should claim all thought for Marxist ideology and then push it onto the public at large. It's very eye-opening when you see how all these humanistic ideologies such as gender theory and critical race theory and the like emerged from Gnostic thought, which was largely what Marx built his theories on. And then realize that it was slowly pushed into Western education in order to get into the minds of the young so that they would overturn essentially the history of human thought, the history of human intelligence, the history of human art and science and philosophy, which is exactly what Marx wanted. He said repeatedly in his writings, and I wrote an article on this for the blog, he said in his writings that the purpose of his writings, he understood his writings to be absolute garbage, dung is what he called them. And he acknowledged that the purpose of his writings was to burn down civilization. He wanted to destroy and ruin everything to the point where humanity literally devoured itself and killed itself and annihilated every form of existence that we know. He blatantly said and acknowledged that he believed God was real, and his purpose for writing his writings was to take the throne from God and rule and destroy, well, not rule, but destroy and demolish God's creation. He was a sadistic, evil human being. And his desire, his thought and his writing should not be permitted to govern society in any way. As God says in the Bible, said to the Israelites, we need to purge the evil from among us. We need to purge these thoughts, these doctrines, these ideologies, these evil, horrendous, disgusting, vile again, I can't think, can't talk right now, I apologize. Disgusting, well, I already said it, we'll just go with doctrines because that's exactly what they are. We need to purge them from our society. And if we don't stand up against them, if we don't lobby for conservative values and for tradition to remain in our society, then we're just slowly going to watch it crumble. It's up to us to take a stand. It's up to us to be courageous. It's up to us to fight for absolute truth. It's up to us to advance not just science, but every subject matter and vie for dialogue between all of them so that we can fully understand and comprehend the mysteries of reality and of our existence. And so we can pass that along to our children so we can build them up and give them a moral backbone so that they don't succumb to the evil and selfishness of liberal ideologies. We are going to take one more break, and then we'll come back. And then I am actually going to read one more read a story that I actually think pertains and does match up with what we've talked about so far. So please stay tuned, and we will be right back. Welcome back to Biblical News Source, everybody. I'm your host, Chris Wright, and we have one last story for you. But before we get to it, though, just one final reminder that we are sponsored today by Crossway Connect. When you join Crossway Connect, you're joining a community of Americans who understand the importance of your health, that your health plays in your overall quality of life. Their community of members have come together to help one another access affordable health care outside of the health insurance market. Crossway Connect is not health insurance. They are a nonprofit, ACA-exempt healthcare sharing ministry utilizing innovative banking technology to provide an enhanced member experience. Through their comprehensive healthcare sharing program options, Crossway Connect provides their members with affordable access to healthcare they need to lead happy and healthy lives. They put you in control of your healthcare by offering a variety of program options to fit your needs and budget, while also allowing you to receive the care you want from the doctors you choose. They are budget-friendly, they share your beliefs, their sharing services are fast and reliable, and they offer a ton of extra benefits, including discounts and telemedicine services. Enrollment is super easy. Just call or go to crosswayconnect.org to fill out their quick and easy application and use code 10MinuteChurch, no spaces and no caps, or click the link in the bio for this episode. They have plans to help get you the assistance you need, so don't pass this up. Check them out today. So I wasn't originally planning on staying on Twitter for the whole time, but this story was just too good to pass up because it connects to everything that we've just been talking about. So you guys, you've got to hear this. This guy on Twitter said this story. He this is something that he actually experienced, and it's not the first time I've heard this. Like, other people have experienced this too. It's just proof that society is crumbling and turning into mindless mush because they're being told to pursue their desires instead of to actually learn how to think. This is what happened to this guy. He said, "So I am at Walmart scanning and bagging my almost $300 worth of groceries while the employee monitors, and then this happened. Her: why are you double bagging all of your groceries? Me: excuse me. Her: you are wasting our bags. Me: if you don't like the way I'm bagging the groceries, feel free to come on over here and bag them yourself. Her: that's not my job. Me: okay, then I will bag my groceries how I please if that's all right with you. Her: why are you using two bags? Me: because the bags are weak and I don't want the handles to break or the bottoms to rip out. Her: well, that's because you are putting too much stuff in the bag. If you took half of that stuff out and put it in a different bag, then you wouldn't need to double bag. 10 seconds of me just staring at her. Then me: so you want me to split these items in half and put half of them in a different bag so that I don't have to double bag? Her: exactly. Me: so I would still be using two bags to hold the same number of items? Her: no, because you wouldn't be double bagging. Me: pressing two fingers to my left eye in an attempt to make it stop twitching. Me: okay, so here I have a jug of milk and a bottle of juice double bagged. If I take the milk out and remove the double bagging and just put the milk in the single bag and the juice in that single bag, I'm still using two bags for these two items. Her: no, because you are not double bagging them, so it's not the same number of bags. Me: looking around at about 10 other customers who at this point are enjoying the show. Me: is this like that Common Core math stuff I keep hearing about? Her: never mind, you just don't get it. And with that, she went back to her little podium so she could continue texting or playing games on her phone or whatever it was she was doing before she decided to come over and critique my bagging skills. What am I supposed to say to this? It's proof. Like, to that one person who said that math and reading is being taught, well, maybe it is being taught, but it's obviously not being taught well. We have tons of people like this who are at basic jobs like this, and don't even get me started on the fact that the self checkout people who just stand there and monitor really are not doing anything at all. It's not really a job. It's just literally, it's ridiculous. But that's another rabbit hole we can go down some other time. But this girl literally could not think. She could not understand what the guy was saying. Like, it doesn't matter how many bags were on his items. He still need, if he puts them all in single bags, he's still using the same amount of bags for those items than if he was double bagging. And she literally was like, he just couldn't, he couldn't wrap his mind around it. He's probably reacting like the rest of us are, just standing there like utterly speechless, because we can't understand how this person we're speaking to can't literally think and figure out the ratio for themselves. Again, this is not the first time I've heard a story like this. It's partially laziness, but it's also because our culture teaches our children and teaches adults even that they should go out and pleasure themselves and do whatever feels right, instead of actually building their minds, building their intellects, and filling themselves with knowledge that they can then compare and contrast. We don't have any discernment. We have experts in meaningless topics, namely all these theories that popped up during postmodernism, especially gender theory and critical race theory and radical feminism. All of these are just theories. They're not actually proven. These are thoughts that were cooked up by scholars and universities that were then passed on to university students and then sent out into the world. They're literally unprovable. They're just assumed. And literally no scholarship that I have ever read, or that any real serious person has read from these quote unquote scholars, has actually made sense. As a matter of fact, most of the time they're very convoluted and difficult to understand. And that's because they don't want you to fully understand it. They want you to be confused, because if you're confused, then you can't think for yourself. You can't understand for yourself. You can't make your own judgments. You can't discern, which is exactly what we were talking about, the process that what I wrote in my tweet. Let me read it again, just so everybody can hear it, in case you missed it. This was my tweet. I said, the broad procedure now is to teach kids what to think instead of how to think, which is why we have seen a measurable drop in IQs. Critical contemplation requires the active comparison and contrasting of multiple available viewpoints, information, and data sets, a weighing of the evidence, in other words. But they don't want kids doing that, because if they do, then they will develop minds of their own and be capable of successfully contributing to society in beneficial ways. We need to get back to the roots of education and abandon this Marxist anti-intellectualism. Education was not meant to be political. When it arose from societies that were deeply Christian, and even before that, when it arose from Greek society, it was largely anti-political. It was meant to fill the mind and create independent thinkers, those who could actually contribute thoughtfully and critically to society in order to prevent mind washing and indoctrination and eliminate slavery and all these other things. I mean, for example, think of Socrates. If we go all the way back to Greek society, Socrates was hated by the people. And why was he hated by the people? Because he questioned everything. He was curious. He wanted to know. He wanted to go deeper into things. He had deeply and profoundly intellectual conversations with people that just left them frustrated because he could actually think for himself. He wasn't just following the crowd. He literally went out of his way to try to understand the reality around him. It was a common venture. Every day he woke up and he continued with that. But today we don't have people with that same dedication, that same devotion. The truth is they don't want to work hard. They want everything handed to them. And that's the problem. This religion of self creates lazy freeloaders. That's what it does. They want everything handed to them. So they pretend to be victims, even though society has literally done nothing wrong to them. They have the same opportunity that everybody else has. Freedom of opportunity in the US, that's what it was built on. It was created for the people so that they could all be on an equal playing field, no matter who they were. Did it always play out that way appropriately? No, but because of the Constitution and the way it was laid out to branch out and describe and set in ink the template of a government where the people were on an equal playing field and could work hard and take hold of the opportunities made available to them so that they could live a successful, a beautiful, a profound and wonderful life. That's it. Because that was set in stone, those rights, that right to opportunity, that right to be able to fight for what you, for the opportunities that were brought before you, to make a successful impact on the world, was possible. If it wasn't for the Constitution that laid that out, if it wasn't for that, democratic republic, that constitutional republic that was constructed based on natural law and biblical principles, then we would have nothing. We would be stuck under the tyranny of King George. I just did a special last week. It was on the 6th of July, but it was in response to the 4th of July. And I read the Declaration of Independence. And in that document, it spells out a view of a very tyrannical ruler. King George was reckless. He was a power monger. He literally wanted to build himself up and lord himself over the people. It was all about his wealth. It was not about uplifting them. It was about shoving them down. They were his subjects. They were not his constituents. They were not his people. And so, our forefathers for this country took a stand and fought against King George in order to develop a country based on liberty, based on freedom, the freedom to choose, the freedom to, but not just the freedom to choose, but the freedom to choose what is best for everybody, the freedom for the majority to enact their sovereignty, and for the government to hold, for the government to be in service to the people instead of for the people in service to the government. It was a complete flip on the past status quo of history. That's why America is so unique and so profound. And now we're watching it and watching it crumble. You want to know what progress is? The libs are so adamant about progressing, about moving. And like I said in the last segment, they never define where we're moving. Well, I'll tell you where we're moving. Unguided progress without boundaries and standards is like a spiraling plane nosediving into the ground. And if we don't grab control of it and reestablish boundaries and standards, then all we are going to see is our society, our existence, explode and crumble into nothing. Like the captains of the plane, we will go down, and everybody on board is going to be wiped out. That's the only way progress without boundaries and standards, unguided progress, leads. And that's all we've got for today. Thank you for tuning in. It's a pleasure as always. May God bless you. And I love you all. And thank you for tuning in. Have a great week. I will not see you next week because I will be out of town and spending time with family. But I will be back the following week for some more biblical news source and some more great stories for you. So hang in there, stay courageous, be strong, and stand up for your values. Stand up for the values that this country was built on. Grace and peace.